Senator Matt Canavan joins us right now, along with the wonderful Sam Crosby, both fired up, both ready to go. Because we're doing rock and roll in a second, it's all you boys for the next few minutes. So let's get to this. Matt, what do you think happened in the NT? Now, we know crime was the issue. Is there something bigger that happened in the Northern Territory? Because they didn't just change, they flogged the Labor Party, that being the CLP.
Well, I think it does show and represent the general unhappiness Australians have right now with the direction of their country, their territory, their state, whatever it is. Obviously, there were some local issues there in the NT as always, but to receive the spanking of this kind, there probably is this underlying concern from Australians that things just aren't going that well right now. I mean, pretty much everywhere you look, you mentioned law and order, which is a big issue for some, but obviously everybody goes to the shops on a weekly basis, and everything costs more and more. People who owe a mortgage are paying thousands of dollars or more on their repayments in just the last couple of years. Our hospitals are bulging and just can't seem to deal with even not life-threatening but serious injuries on a timely basis. Our roads have massive potholes in them that just didn't exist years ago. It doesn't seem to be raining any harder, but things just aren't seem to be keeping up. Our nation's sort of crumbling around us, and so I think that's what's happening here, and it's a tough time for incumbent governments that don't have the answers. Certainly federally, we've got one of those governments that's flailing around right now and not really sure about itself and doesn't really have any solutions to these massive problems facing Australians today.
Yeah, Sam, I also think it relates a little back to just the principle of what that Republican bloke was saying on CNN. I know you were taking notes. Him saying, well, you can't tell people that their lived experience is different than what it actually is, right? Now, governments of all persuasions at some point in time end up saying, well, this data says it's better than you think it is,
but the Treasury's told me life's good.
Yeah, it's like, well, this one's up, this one's down. I think that's the lesson for Albo, Chalmers and the rest of them, is to actually engage with something as it is, not as someone can represent it to be.
Look, I think you're right, and notwithstanding Matt's very ungracious comments about the federal government, I think a lot of these points are correct, that long-term governments, after a while, they have to wear the blame for everything that's going wrong in someone's life. Let me put one other theory out there as to, I think, why we as the Labor Party did so poorly on the weekend. I think this government's last term was horribly, horribly inconsistent. You know, if you look at
three chief ministers, policy.
Well, that's right. Like, if are you pro fracking or are you anti fracking? Are you pro, you know, tough on crime, or are you pro a softer approach? I almost don't even know if it matters which side you pick, as long as you stick to it and you believe in it and you've got some evidence to back it up. I mean, at some stage, the rubber's going to have to hit the road and you've got to hope it works. But they got eaten from the left and the right. They got all the worst parts of going to the left and all the worst parts of going to the right. Yeah. At no stage does it seem like they actually sat down and thought, well, hold on, what's actually going to work to deliver the outcomes that we promised?
Well, what'll be fascinating to watch too is, remember, one of the negotiations currently making its way in and around Canberra is, in order to get some federal finance stuff changed, will they double the number of senators that come from territories? Now, of course, that'll produce way more lefties out of the ACT, but with the Greens being able to get enough of a vote to take over, say, the richest part of Darwin, that being in and around Fanny Bay, do they end up now in a scenario where they're going to start threatening for one of the four spots rather than the even divide, again, potentially making it even further to the left? All wait, watch and see. It is always interesting, by the way, how the richies go green first, isn't it? Anyway, what about the farmers today, Matt, when they decided to give it to Jacinta Allen? She was there at the Bush Summit. This one was in Victoria, I think in Bendigo. My mate Rita Panahi was there, yeah, along with many others. This is some of the reaction that came from farmers when Allen was, well, talking up her own book. Have a look.
It also provides not just a more secure form of energy, it's a cheaper form of energy. We're nearly at 40%.
Yeah. So how do we get... excuse, ladies and gentlemen...
Oh, she didn't like that, did she? Now, of course, perfect example about what's happening around places like Ballarat. Now, I don't understand how Ballarat sent Labor MPs back to the Victorian Parliament at the last election, when that is the absolute heart of one of those areas where, because Melbourne has decided we're going renewable energy, places like Ballarat are the ones who have to put up with the massive disruption to their farms. That, in part, is why they called BS, but she didn't like it, did she?
No, she didn't, Paul. And I just want to segue from your last comment about rich areas going green first. I just wish we'd impose green policies on those areas first too. I mean, I think that what needs to happen, because what tends to seem to happen is the rich people vote for the Greens and then the Greens policies get imposed out in the bush, in the rural areas. They're the ones that have to suffer among these massive bird-killing wind turbines and hectares full of mirrors in their beautiful landscapes. That's why there's this reaction going on in the bush, and obviously Premier Allan seems completely deaf to it. I don't know how she thought that would go down well. It goes also back to what you said about politicians telling people that their lived experience is wrong. Because how could you get up and say with a straight face that renewables is the cheapest form of power? I mean, everybody in that room has got a power bill in the last quarter. Everybody can see their power bills go through the roof at the same time that the Victorian government, more than any other apart from South Australia, has been rolling out renewables at a record pace. How could you say that with a straight face? And that's why people are losing trust in politicians. It's why you're seeing these reactions at the ballot post box. And in terms of Ballarat at the state election, the problem there, Paul, was there wasn't an alternative. The Victorian Liberals at that election were as gung-ho as the Labor Party on the climate agenda, if not more so. That's a bit different now federally, because we've got Peter Dutton, the leader, who's backing nuclear energy and saying no to this reckless rollout of renewables across our beautiful, pristine Australian landscapes.